Good evening. This video recording is the continuation of the discussion of the topics that you covered already for the Chapter 2 of our course, Systems Administration and Maintenance. No, and according to Sir Nunga, you're then discussing the following, the definition of the system, its network infrastructure, and you also discuss about the von Neumann computer architecture, which composes mainly with the CPU, memory, and disk, and then handling hardware. You also discuss that. Next is the another aspects of hardware, is the extent to which weather and environment are important for operation, such as the lightning, power failure, heat, cold, and humidity. Although cold is not a problem here in the Philippines since we don't experience winter. Next, you also tackled about the operating systems, which definitely kernel was mentioned. And then I guess you also familiar with the list of different operating systems from MSPC-DOS and up to Windows 10, which is currently the latest version of Windows, and then the Linux, Mac OS, and the early versions of MS or Microsoft. Then the next is the shells or command interpreters, which will have a demo on how to use some of the useful command under CMD. But before that, let's talk about these logs and audits. So when we say logs, it is the process, no, logging every single operation that the computer performs. So in here, you can also check whether there is a malware or there is someone who already gained access on your devices. So how to check the logs and audits of your computer? Probably until now, since you're using computers for years, I do believe some of you are not aware that there is a default application or program installed on every operating system that can log and audit our operations, such as when you open a program, when you type something in a CMD. So to do that, first, we need to go to start, and then you just need to simply type event viewer. So this is an application or a program which is pre-installed when we install the operating system. So this is the environment or the window of event viewer. Basically, we need to look under Windows logs. And then next is the application. So here we have the different type of information provided by the operating system, in which example here, Firefox default browser agent. So it was opened 6:29 p.m. today. Then the other thing, asset, GP update, search, since I've searched on my device, when log on, since you log on to your computer, maybe I restarted my computer on this during this time. And then a lot of information are here. So let me share an incident. No, one of my friends that owns a private server was attacked by a malware, and then we found out that the the server was attacked using a virus, a Trojan virus, and we trace that activity using this event viewer. So hopefully during our synchronous meeting, I can show you, the server environment of the private server known friend ko. So that's the event viewer. That's the logs and audits. Then I believe that you end the discussion here. And there are lots of command prompts provided to us by Windows. For example, when you want to open an application. So basically, we double click the icon, no, the shortcut of the application or the executable file of such software or program. But you can also open an application using a CMD command. So to do that, again, let's go to start, and then you just need to type CMD. For this activity or for this demonstration, we need to open the CMD as administrator, since some of the commands are needs, no, to be executed under the administrator privilege. If you just click command prompt right now, meaning you are only given, no, the privilege as user or guest user. So let's open that application as guest user, and then let's open another instance of CMD as administrator. So once you click administrator, there is a prompt that will ask you, do you want to allow this app to make changes to your device? Just click yes, and then another instance of CMD will be provided to us. So first, for the user privilege, you can see on the title bar, it's only stated here, command prompt. So selected, it means the window currently selected is this window. Now, for the administrator instance, the difference is you can see an administrator word here. So we'll be using the administrator one. So first, the command provided on the PowerPoint presentation is dir. It means directory. It simply shows you the content of the current folder where you are right now inside your command prompt. So in my case, I'm in C Windows System 32. As you can see, there are 4,531 files inside this directory. And even the size is also provided here. The counter Linux command for that is ls, or what we call ls. Now, the folders or the files listed on our directory shown, no, simultaneously. What if you want to pause the output or the display? So simply you just type dir again and then provide another parameter, which is slash p or pause. So once you press enter, it will only shows, I guess, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 15, or less than 20 items. It depends on the size of your command prompt. Then once you press enter again, the next batch of the files will be provided up to the last part or last file on this directory. So if you want to exit on this display, you just need to press Ctrl C. That's the shortcut key to exit the or to end the execution of the command. Now, another simple command is, for example, we want to create a folder. No, so let's try here on the desktop. So let me show my desktop folder. I have so far 2, 4, 6, 7. So we have one folder named para sa MGC, MAGC. Now, if you want to create a folder here, we just simply right-click and then new, and then we just select folder. But again, to do that in CMD, you need to type here, okay? So we have the folder, how to create a folder here. So we have a commands, copying, moving, clearing a folder. We have MD to create a folder, and then for Linux is mkdir. So let's try first, if you want to clear the screen, then you just type cls. Okay? So let's make a folder inside desktop. So to do that, again, let's check the desktop environment. We have here now this window. So to go to desktop, we need to type cd dot dot. It means we'll move one up from the current directory or folder. Now, we'll we will again move another directory, which is cd dot dot. So to check where we can find the desktop directory, desktop is under users. So to go to users, we need to use the command cd or change directory. And then just type the folder name or directory name. So in this case, it's user. We have it here. So now, you can see on the command prompt, it's cd users. Then to check again the list of files, just type dir. Then the currently, I have this Kelios as the user currently logged in on my machine. So you just type cd Kelios and then dir, and there you can find the desktop directory. So to go there, just type cd desktop and then dir. We can see now the same items here on this window para sa MAGC, Cisco Packet Tracer Shortcut, Microsoft Teams, Mobile Legends, student.php, Tongitsgo, and Zoom. So to create a folder, again, we need to type MD or make directory. And then you just type, for example, SAM, S-A-M. Then just type enter. Then we can see now here another folder, no, was created inside the desktop folder by just typing this command MD SAM. Okay, so next. There are some commands, no, that are not listed here on the PowerPoint, but were also discussed during the synchronous meeting with the other section. So first, let me introduce to you that command. Let's go first with the attribute. Attrib, it means you need to change the attribute of a certain folder, and then we have parameter cden, read only, dash h, dash r, dash s, asterisk, that asterisk, it means all files inside that directory, and then just press enter. So what is the use of this command? Mostly, some of us, no, if not all, some of us already encountered when you insert your flash drive in others' computer, or let's say public computer such as computer shop or in school. And then when you insert that flash drive in your machine, unfortunately, you cannot see your files. Instead, there are files inside that flash drive which are .lnk or shortcut links. And then when you click that file, it says the file was corrupted or something like that. Then your file or the true file is not there, which is you are now thinking that it might be deleted or gone or corrupted. But again, it's a virus, which that virus do is to hide your actual files, and then instead of that folder or directory, they will provide you a shortcut key or shortcut icon for those files. And then they will hide those files inside a folder, which is actually a name, no? Folder. It doesn't contain any characters. So you need to type attribute this command to display again those hidden files in your flash drive. So again, here it only took roughly 10 seconds because the file size is only 28 megabytes. But for some instance, like you have 4 gigs, 16 gigs, 80 gigs, it will take some time, no? Probably 15 or 10 minutes. Okay? Next is tracer. So when we say tracer, we need to trace the route. So for Linux, the counter command for that is trace route. So tracer, for example, from your computer, when you type facebook.com, we know that if you're connected to the router, the your machine or your computer will send a request. No, that request will be passed to your router going to outside network. Then the question is, how many hubs, how many router does that request, no, process, no, or conducted during that traceroute command. So let's try tracert facebook.com. Since I'm here in our barangay, hopefully it will show some output here. But most of the times when you're just using a hotspot, it will provide an output such as asterisk, asterisk, and then the result is request timeout. That means probably the cell phone is not allowing you to see the route, you know, from your laptop or PC going to the outside network of your phone. But if you are using a router right now, probably you will see a different output for this command. Instead of request timeout, it will show you some of the route here. You will see a foreign IP address, and then it depends how many route does it take from your device going to the server or the target IP address or domain. Okay, so that's tracer. Next, if you want to check the network stability or your internet connection, you can just simply type the command ping, and then you ping a website, let's say pinggoogle.com. By default, if you did not enter any parameter, it will only give you four response. So here we can see some of the information or data here. Reply from, so we type google.com, it means this is the IP address of google.com. And then bytes, the size of the bytes or the request or the packet, and then the ping, which is 143 ms, which is not good. Basically it should be below 100, so sometimes it's not disabled. If you have a result like 500 700 1000, meaning you have a red ping, no, your stable is not your internet connection is not stable. And then TTL is time to live. So far, since there's no request timeout, there are no lost packets on that request. Now, if you want a continuous monitoring of the ping result, you just need to type ping google.com then -t. So as you can see now, the output, it's not only 4 requests, but instead it will keep you an update every how many milliseconds, no? It will request a ping from your machine going to Google, and then you can see here the delay. So 81, it's not stable. Now let me try to open a browser. Let's say I'll type youtube.com. Let's check the network there. So you can see from less than 100, it went up to 224. So it depends on the network traffic that you are you have, and then the speed of your internet connection plus the number of users. It can affect the result of this ping result. So again, let's exit that using Control C. Next, another command for this is, let's have next is system information. So if you want to check the information of your computer, you just need to type system info. Now it will provide you the host name, the OS version, even the registered owner, and then what is the system type, which is 64 bit, and then the size of the memory, RAM, even the page file location, the virtual memory, what else, the brand of the device that you're using. So everything is provided here. You just need to type system information. Next, to check your battery or the power configuration of your computer, so we need to type power CFG for config, and then energy. So it says here that we need to wait for 60 seconds. No. So while we're waiting for that, we'll discuss the file system. So when you say file system, you need to check the version of your operating system. We have two types. Again, to check that, you can type system info inside CMD, or you can just simply right click disk PC or my computer, and then select properties, or you press window post break on your keyboard to go to the computer properties. Then we can see now here 64 bit. So what's the difference? 64 bit, it means you can use RAM or memory. For example, 1 terabyte, 512 gigabytes of RAM. So for 32 bit, sometimes it's not 32-bit here, it represents as 86. So 86 is the 32-bit. Even though you have installed 18 or 16 gigs of RAM on your computer, that 16 gigabytes is not usable or not available. 32-bit operating system can only allocate or use a maximum of 4 gigabytes of RAM. So if you want to upgrade your RAM, you need to check first your operating system. For example, you have 4 gigabytes right now, and then you want to buy another 8 gigabytes or 4 gigabytes, you might need to upgrade the version of your OS or the system type from 32-bit to 64-bit. So still, we don't have yet the result for the Power Config. Let's continue the discussion. Now, for Windows file model, Windows OS supports a variety of legacy file system for backward compatibility. So we don't need to worry with those compatibility issues. And now we have here the NTFS or the new technology file systems. Nowadays, the default file type for flash drive. Let me insert a flash drive so that you will know where you can find that NTFS. So I'm inserting my flash drive right now. Let's go to this PC. Then here's my flash drive. So to check what type of file system currently applied on that specific drive, it's just you need to right click it and then select format, but you don't need to format the flash drive. And then you can see here NTFS is the file system. So if you want to make it FAT32 by default, okay, so if you're playing or if you want to use your flash drive to play MP3 on your DVD player, okay, or other appliances, you might need to change that from NTFS to FAT32 because those multimedia players doesn't support backward compatibility. Now, right-click, properties, you can see here the file system is NTFS. So when you reformat this flash drive into FAT32, when you click properties, it will state here FAT32. FAT stands for file allocation table. Okay, NTFS is new technology file system. Okay, so let's continue the discussion. Again, for file system layout, probably you're wondering why when you install a fresh copy of an operating system, it always automatically save into drive C. So the reason for that, historically reason, is that drive A is normally allotted or reserved for diskette. Again, it's not a joke, or it's a joke, no? That A is reserved for Apple. No, A is intended for diskette stations. I guess most of you did not use diskette, no? Because diskette were used during way back 1990s. But for your info, this is the image or sample of diskette. It can only save, up to 5 MB. So you cannot save a movie here. You can just save Word files, doc files, something like that, or text files. And then drive B, since you have another diskette, so they provided another interface, or slot for floppy disk station or diskette station. That's why drive A and drive B are not available when we install or reformat our computer, or install a new or fresh copy of an operating system. That's why it's drive C as the primary hard drive station or disk partition. And then other drive names are assigned at random, but often drive H is reserved for partitions containing users' home directories. So you need to remember that. And then we have here the directory CI386. This directory contains the binary code and data for the Windows operating system. So we don't need to edit this one because we need to normally leave this alone. Why? Because if we mess with this file system, probably we'll encounter loading encounter problem loading your operating system. Same as with system program files, this is the default location or official location for new software. So, for example, when you install Adobe Photoshop, Notepad++, or VS Code, when you check on the location, by default, it says there C program files backslash and then the name of the software or application that you're installing. Then we have the temporary scratch space. So how to go there? Again, you need to go click start, and then you type run. We need to run the type run the run application. So if you want to do that, so this is the window of run. You just simply type window R, okay? And then you need to type %temp%. So this will allow us to go to the temporary directory. So here we have other stuff, like when you download something from the internet, they are saved here temporarily. When you open an application, there are some temporary files. So we need to right click properties. Currently, I have 113 MB of trash files here. So you can delete these files if you want to, if you don't need them. Then some of the files here cannot be deleted because this folder no is currently open. So probably there's an application here that is currently open and is using this temporary directory. So please check your temp files, because last time that we checked this, one of the students have at least 5 gigabytes of space no consumed by the temporary files. So next, we have the Windows WinNT. This is the root directory for the Windows system. And WinNT config, so it contains the configuration information for the programs, generally no binary files. And then system 32, this is the whole system root. We have here now the different, again, to go there, you just simply open the run application, then type system 32, which will redirect you to the directory of the system 32. Here we can see the DLL files, the different libraries needed by the operating system to run smoothly. Even calculator was here, or is here, there. MS Paint, GPedit, which we'll be using for the next lab activities. So everything that the computers need to run are listed here. So this is the root directory of our operating system. So before we continue with the discussion, let's check. So there, unable to perform operation. So let's try again. So there is an error, no? When I type power CFG energy. So let's wait for 1 minute. Let's continue again here. File extensions. So you're very familiar with file extensions such as .exe, .jpg, .doc. Now, what if you have a file, or some of your friends sends you a file with unfamiliar file extension, and you want to know where you can run such files? So again, using CMD, let's close this again. Okay. So using CMD, we can type ASOC, and then you just simply type the extension name of your file. For example, ASOC.doc. You can see here that that doc files can be run or open using Word application. For example, just ASOC alone without any parameter, it will shows you all the registered and known file system or extension on your operating system, plus the program that can run such extension name or files. So for example, we have here that that .evo, you can open that .evo files using VLC. What else? That .drc can also be run or open using VLC application. So you can see that there, the different file extensions together with the program associated with those extension names. So next, let's go with The Linux and shortcuts, again, Linux has ways of aliasing files in the file system. Windows has hard links or duplicate entries in the master file. Basically, to create a shortcut link, we just simply, where's my directory? Okay. So we just simply right-click the file that we want to create a shortcut and then send to desktop create shortcut. Okay. So that's the simplest way using the GUI. Next, access control list is a familiar term for you since you already studied Cisco 1 and Cisco 2. The access control list was mentioned there, and the when ACL discussed, it is meant to block, you know, the ports or some traffic coming in and coming out from our network. So for operating system or under system administration and maintenance, access control list for file systems intends to, you know, give permission to the user, such as read only, or the user can write and read, can execute the file, can delete. Okay, what is the permission given? And then the O stands for the ownership, and then G is to grant access to the user, E is to edit, T is to act on the files or subdirectories, and then R, no, to revoke or remove access rights to the specific user, and then lastly D is deny access rights. So those are just examples of access control lists. We will not discuss them further in this chapter, but when we go to the host and user management topic, we will discuss this access control list. So window sharing, how to share a folder in Windows through a network. You just simply right-click properties or give access to a specific people. And then this window will pop up, and then you select which user, or you can select everyone. It means everyone that has access to this machine can access that folder, and then you can change the permission and so on and so forth. Okay. So Windows process model, we can open or start an application in CMD. For example, we want to open calculator. We don't need to go to system root or C, or start, and then type calculator. Instead, you go to CMD and then just type calc, or simply calculator. Then the calculator application will pop up. For example, you want to type gpedit.msc, or sorry, gpedit.msc. Then this is the group policy editor or directory. So we'll be using this by, I think, fifth week of midterms until our final term. No. What else? MS Paint. So you can also use open MS Paint here. Hey, so what if I type a misspelled command? Definitely, CMD or Windows will respond or will reply with this message. The command that you type is not recognized as an internal or external command, so operable program or batch file. Okay, so for example, you do have a command here, you know a command, and then you don't know what's the next parameter. You can simply type the command and then slash question mark, and it will give you the list of parameters of options on how to use the command that you entered, just like in Cisco Packet Tracer. When you type question mark, it will provide you the list of commands available. No. So let's check the previous instance, or let's type again power CFG. Hopefully it will work this time. Energy. Okay, let's wait for another minute. While we're waiting, we'll continue the discussion. Networks. So just same as with the other section, we discussed this one, but we did not dive deeper on the topic because it was again already taught to you during your Cisco 1 and 2. We all know that network is the largest physical physical entity to to our computer systems, but it's also the least conspicuous. Often, these are hidden behind walls, such as yung mga cables natin and other stuff. So networking is increasingly important as computers are used more and more as devices for media access rather than for computation. So networking raises issues for system management and many levels. That's why you are here right now as network administrator major, because you want to be a network admin in the future. So we begin with the OSI model. Again, basically we have 7 layers. We have the layer 1, which is the physical layer, and when we say physical layer, cables, interfaces such as the wireless LAN adapter, Ethernet cables, or Ethernet adapters. So they will fall under physical layer. For data link layer, which is the layer 2, these are the protocol, Ethernet protocol. And then for network layer, we have the IP or the Internet protocol. Then transport layer, it depends if the transport protocol was TCP or transmission control protocol or the UDP. For session layer, we talk about sockets, RPC. And then presentation layer, the user routines or the XDR. And then lastly, the application layer, which are the program protocol commands. So at the lowest level, the sending of data between two machines takes place by manipulating voltage along the wire. So for physical layer, it's either we talk about the satellite, wireless, Wi-Fi, fiber optics, copper cable, or even the coaxial cable for those who have a cable internet connection there. And then data link layer, we have here the term MAC address. So how to know what is your MAC address? Again, by going to CMD. Where's my command prompt? Okay, so before we continue there, let's go here to our power config energy. So we have 20 errors, 9 warnings, 29 informational. So that's the report of the power config energy. And then it says here that if you want to see more details about that report, we can go to cusers kelios desktop energy report.html. So we can go now to desktop directory, and then there's an energy report.html provided. So earlier there's no such file, no, listed here. So since after that command, your computer will automatically generate a report in the HTML format or file extension. Then we have errors here, such as the disk idle is disabled on battery. So I intentionally do that. I don't want to turn off the power of my hard drive if I'm not using my computer. Then USB selective suspends. You can also suspend the power usage of your USB ports if you want to. And then the sleep. For example, by default, your laptop, when it's not plugged in, when your laptop is using the battery, after, let's say, 5 minutes, it depends on the configuration, it will go under sleep state or hibernate. Okay? To conserve energy or battery. But for me, since I'm always plugging in my laptop, so I suspend that configuration. And for Windows, it will provide you that that configuration is considered as an error. So it's not an error because I intentionally do that. What else? So we have here warnings. So for example, as shown earlier, I have here a web browser, and it says that this application consumes a lot of processor. So you can check now, no, when you open Microsoft Edge, Mozilla Firefox, and even Google Chrome, you can compare the result of this power config energy to check which of the 3 browsers utilizes more with your processor. So this is just the example of reports provided by PowerCFG-Energy. And even the battery of the laptop was here. Battery ID, manufacturer, serial number, last full charge, and then design capacity. So there. Okay. Next. For example, you want to check your file systems in your operating system. Some of you, okay, probably did not encounter personally the error boot manager not found or operating system missing or encountered a boot loop with their operating system. So how to check if your files are still healthy? So we can just simply type here SFC and then / question mark. So to check which of the following parameters available to use. So here we have the SFC / scan now. So we'll be using that one, / scan now. Now it will begin the system scan. This will take some time. So as you can see here, it's only 2%. I think 2 to 3 minutes will be enough to check your file system. Okay, so while we're waiting again, let's go back to our discussion here. So for OSI model network layer, as I've mentioned, we talk about the IP address. Again, when you say physical address, that is the MAC address. When you say logical address, that is the IP address. So don't mix them up. Transport layer, so we concentrate on this layer for much of the following chapters. Okay, again, the transport layer builds packets. We all know that the data that we transfer or send to another network are chopped into chunks, or divided into chunks. And then we call those chunks our packets, as packets. And then session layer, this is the part of a host operating system which helps a user program to set up a connection. That's the reason why the switch or the router continuously blinking. It means they are setting up a established connection, and then it will tell you if the connection is still waiting or time's out. And then presentation layer, this is the role played by the external data representation or XDR in the RPC system. And then lastly, the application layer, these are the program which wants to send data, most probably the web browser, because we have here FTP or the file transfer protocol, and then the HTTP, which is the hypertext transfer protocol. So cables and interfaces technologies, different vendors have invested in different networking technologies with different media access control. Again, MAC address is unique, so you don't have any you don't have same MAC address with other users computers in the world. So those are unique. It's a 60-odd, it's a hexadecimal value from 0 to F. Then we have the different approach such as bus or Ethernet. Again, these were already discussed during your Cisco 1 and Cisco 2 subject. Token ring, frame relay, and ATM. Now, when it comes to connectivity, network cables are joined together by hardware, which makes sure that messages are transmitted from cable to segment in the right direction. But again, we can call it a network, but only peer-to-peer, without any special device. For example, one PC to another PC, you can connect them through a cable, straight through or crossover. So still, that's a network connection, but it is limited to two hosts. But if we want to extend or expand our network from one network to another, we need this special hardware, such as routers, which can filter unwanted traffic for security purposes. I think nakakita na kayo ng router, especially NA kayo. And hopefully, you already configured a router since third year na kayo. And you're using Packet Tracer for how many semesters na. And then Bridge is a hardware device which acts like a filter on busy network. I think dito, not all of you, already configured the bridge, because sometimes maliit lang yung network, you don't need to expand or connect one house to another using a bridge. So basically, it works like a mini router. No, it separates two segments of the same cable. And then repeater, it's an amplifier that strengthens the network signal over long stretch of cables. When you say repeater, it's not only applicable for wireless. Ito yung mga tinatawag nating Wi-Fi repeater or Wi-Fi booster. So it's also applicable to router. So you provide another device. So from your main router connected to another router sa ibang bahay, instead of through wireless, you connect them through cable. So that's repeater. And then switch, it's a hub which can direct message from one host cable directly to the intended host. So why we need to use switch? We all know that router are only limited, no? Or has only four or limited slots or ports. So if you want to connect 20 computers in a single network, you need this hardware switch to connect all those computers, especially desktop computers, to your router. Then IP address, you're familiar with the 32-bit or the IPv4, which is the 192.168.0.1. And then the IPv6, which is the hexadecimal value or the new version for IPv4. For IP addresses, we have different class or legacy. So for class A, it starts from 1.0.0.0 to 2.127.255.255.255. So those addresses, we call them class A networks. Originally, it starts with 11.0.0.0, not 1.0.0.0. No? And then these networks likely, no, has or it allows 126 possible networks since the network 127 is reserved for a loopback service. Then the number of hosts per class network is 2,563 minus reserve address on the network. Then we go to class B. Again, na-discuss na to during your Cisco 1 and 2. We talk about 128.0.0 to 191.255.0.0. So these are the class B networks, and there are 16,384 networks inside this class. Then the first two bytes are the next network part, and the last two bytes are the host part. It gives a maximum of 2,562 addresses. Then for class C, which is the common IP address that we're using, even my cell phone, when you check your IP address, by the way, you go to command prompt on how to check your IP address. You just simply type ipconfig or IP configuration, and it will provide you the information of your IP address. So far I have here my IP address is 192.168.43.57. It means this is the IP address of my computer. And then the subnet mask of class C is 255.255.255.0. And then the default gateway is the address of the router. So again, as I mentioned, I don't have a router here. I am only connected through hotspot. So it means this is the IP address of my cell phone when I turn on my hotspot on my computer. Okay? So if you're using a router, definitely this is your router. Now to access that router, you just simply open a browser. If you want to change the password of your Wi-Fi at your home, you just need to type the address 192.168.43.1. Again, unfortunately, this is my cell phone. It will not allow me to enter on its network. But on your case, you can try it. You can access your router and change the Wi-Fi password of your router. Then for class D, this is the what we call M-bone, or the multicast backbone of the network. So this includes addresses from 224.0.0.0 to 239.255.255.0. And then the class E, which is experimental, we have the addresses 240.0.0.0 to 255.255.255.255. So these are unused and are considered experimental. And then we have other addresses. I guess you're familiar with 0.0.0. That's the default route. You studied that when you're using the EIGRP and OSPF during your Cisco 2. And then the loopback address, which is 127.0.0.1, for those who are developing a web application using MySQL. I think you're very familiar with this address, and other addresses are also here. So you just need to check them, no? And review them. So again, that's all for system components, or the chapter 2 of our course, systems administration and maintenance. Okay? So I hope you learned a lot, and let's see each other on our synchronous meeting. So thank you and have a nice day.